This is an ABC News special. Now reporting from Studio One in New York, Peter Jennings.
This broadcast is part of a week-long effort which ABC News is making to address the crisis of health care in the country. Tonight, our aim is to spend 90 minutes discussing a very complicated subject in what we hope will be a simple and straightforward way. This broadcast is about AIDS, which means it's about public health and private agony. It's about prejudice and fear and the awkwardness for most of us of having to talk about very intimate matters far sooner than we might want to. But growing up in the age of AIDS leaves us no choice. This is about sex and death, and there are so many questions which need to be answered.
How do I protect my child from AIDS?
Is it safe to let children go to a school where someone has AIDS?
How do I talk to my kids about AIDS?
I think when you die, you're going to go to a better place. And so I'm not really afraid of dying.
How do you get AIDS?
If you get AIDS, does it mean you're going to die?
How do babies get it?
If you carry HIV and you live long enough, you will indeed develop AIDS and you will die.
My life has been taken away.
Does French kissing increase your risk of getting AIDS?
How can I be sure my boyfriend doesn't have it?
Are condoms 100% effective?
Because of the HIV virus that I have, I will have to retire from the Lakers.
We are 1,000 points of light, and we are being extinguished one by one.
What are the risks of getting it through a blood transfusion?
Is oral sex safe? Is it safer than regular sex?
How should I react to someone who has AIDS?
How do I talk to my parents about AIDS?
All you're thinking is, I want to get high, I want to get high, I want to get high. You don't think about the AIDS. I guess you just, when you get it, then it's too late.
What are my chances of getting AIDS if I'm not a homosexual or drug user?
Can you get fired for having AIDS?
Who pays for people who have AIDS who don't have enough money to get their own health care?
If I get AIDS, will anyone care?
Don Schulberg, Barry Mortham.
People being allowed to die.
Ontario.
Than it's ever done in the past.
When I grow up, will I get AIDS too?
So many questions. Here in our studio audience, we have a lot of young people, and we have some people somewhat older than that, some of whom have questions and some of whom I hope have answers. That's true for some other locations across the country and overseas as well. And as you may have heard before the broadcast, we have an 800 number which you can call with a question. There it is, 1-800-648-8094. I suppose the easiest way to place to start is talking about how people actually just feel about AIDS in general. Can you tell me your name?
My name is Josh.
Are you afraid of AIDS, Josh?
Yes, definitely.
Do you think much about it?
A lot, especially with the relationships.
And you?
Yeah. I've found AIDS to be something, after Magic Johnson's announcement, where it's touched all of us in a great way, we've realized that teenagers aren't invincible.
Are you a teenager?
Yes.
You really think teenagers are not invincible?
Yes. I've realized that.
How about you?
I think it's a very scary thing that's happening, and I don't think anybody's, like, not, you know, everybody can get it, and, you know, everybody has to watch out for it, even teenagers.
Mm-hmm. You and your friends talk about it a lot?
A lot.
More so now than you did a couple years ago, do you think?
Much more.
Mm-hmm. What about the lady behind you?
AIDS is a very, very serious thing and has touched me very deeply. I've lost quite a few friends from the disease. And I want to see our country make a real commitment to fight it and to put resources into fighting this disease.
You think the commitment is there yet?
No.
What about you, sir?
Yeah, well, I think AIDS doesn't discriminate, and it can affect any one of us, so we all got to be careful.
And you, sir?
AIDS is it's very scary, and as she said before, no one's invincible. Mm-hmm. Teenagers, middle-aged people, babies and children.
What about you?
Well, you know, it's a really scary thing. You have like a really small chance of getting it, but if you get it, it's pretty bad. Mm.
It's pretty hard to recognize AIDS, isn't it? Krista, you tell us something about yourself?
I am 19 years old, and I
am infected with HIV. To some people, I have AIDS. So to me, it's very real, and it's very risky, and I'm only a teenager, and that didn't matter.
We're going to ask Krista and a couple of other people here tonight to help us to understand what it feels like to be HIV positive and or have AIDS. What's the difference between being HIV and having AIDS?
Depends on who you ask. Some people tell you it will depend on whether or not you've had opportunistic infections. Some people tell you it depends on your immune system and how much you have left of a certain part of your immune system. I think it has to do with a little bit of both, but I think it has a lot to do with your mental attitude.
Let's go to some of the questions about facts, who has it and really what it is. Joining us is Dr. James Curran, who is in charge of the HIV/AIDS program for the Centers for Disease Control in Atlanta, Georgia. Dr. Curran, would you tell us at the beginning just how many people have AIDS, how many HIV cases are there, and tell us something about the communities it affects, if there's any difference?
Well, Peter, as of the last month, there are more than 206,000 cases of AIDS reported in the United States, nearly 46,000 in the past 12 months alone. 140,000 of these people have been reported to have died. To put it in some perspective, AIDS is now a problem which is a mature, serious health problem in our country. Most of the people who've developed AIDS and have died in the United States were infected even before the virus was discovered. It's really hard for us to imagine that the virus was really non-existent just over 10 years ago, and now it is one of the leading causes of death of young people in this country.
The 11th, I believe, cause of death in the country, is that correct?
Yes, but it's going to be the second leading cause of death in young adults between 25 and 44 within the next 2 years. It's already the second leading cause of death in men.
So is it fair to say there is a real explosion of HIV and AIDS in the teenage population in the country?
Well, teenagers, of course, are particularly vulnerable because they begin to take risks at a time where they may not appreciate the risks. Beginning sexuality, beginning drug use, after you've been exposed to 10 or 20 years of education is a different matter than when these things all occur at once.
Okay, we'll get to talk to a lot of teenagers. Let's go to the phones right away. We have a phone call, I think, from Michigan. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I'd like to know if you can get AIDS from a mosquito bite, if a mosquito bites a person with AIDS. If not, how does that differ from a malaria bite, you know, that's transmitted?
Can you get AIDS from a mosquito? Joining us from San Francisco, here in the studio, is Dr. Nancy Snyderman. She's a surgeon in San Francisco. Sorry, that's Dr. Paul Wolberding. So let's stay there in San Francisco with Dr. Wolberding, who runs the AIDS program at San Francisco General Hospital, has been treating AIDS patients since the very early 80s. Dr. Wolberding, can you get it from a mosquito bite?
No, it's been a question that many people have asked during the epidemic, and the seems to be that the mosquito doesn't really carry enough of the virus to transmit it, even though it does acquire and transmit some blood. Malaria, in contrast, there's a lot of the organism in the mosquito, so the mosquito is able to transmit that infection, but not HIV.
One of the biggest problems that we have had, or at least that I certainly have had in preparing for this broadcast, was the challenge of trying to define AIDS in a couple of paragraphs. You may have heard people say that you can have the virus, which causes AIDS, for several years without any signs of sickness. We think it may be a little easier to understand what we're talking tonight from at least a scientific medical point of view if you can visualize some of it. So here are the couple paragraphs we wrote. See if this helps. This is a photograph taken through an electron microscope. Each of those blue dots is a virus, a human immunodeficiency virus, immuno having to do with the immune system, what you will hear people this evening refer to as HIV. This is how researchers believe the virus causes AIDS. Each virus is an infectious agent of disease. Strictly speaking, the virus is not alive, but once it gets into the body, it begins to have a devastating effect. The virus attacks a particular kind of white cell, the helper T cells. They are the ones which, when they sense an advancing disease, such as the AIDS virus, send the message to other white cells that they must collectively resist.
They're a crucial element in the body's defense system. The virus penetrates the T cells and through a complicated genetic process forces the T cell to manufacture copies of the virus. In the process, the T cell, this essential part of the immune system, dies. And in time, when enough T cells are penetrated, infected, and die, the body is no longer able to fight off the series of devastating infections that we know as AIDS.
One more question at the moment, Dr. Volberding in San Francisco, for you. If I get AIDS, am I automatically going to die?
Well, the chances are unfortunately still very high with the therapies that we have right now. We're trying very hard to come up with treatments that will change that, but so far over 90% of people that we've followed for a long time show evidence that the virus is gradually destroying their immune system, and the chances that those people will die unless we can find a better treatment are very high.
I know there'll be a lot of questions for Dr. Volberding as the program goes on. Joining us here in the studio, as we said, from San Francisco, another doctor, Dr. Nancy Snyderman, who's a surgeon, works on Good Morning America a lot. How do you get AIDS?
You have to get AIDS. You get AIDS by the transfer of infected fluid, bodily fluid, from one person to another. The most common ways: unprotected sex, dirty needles, IV drug users, and in the past, some transfusions before our blood supply in this country became safe. And mothers have about a 1 in 3 chance, if the mothers are infected, of passing HIV onto their babies. Mm. So those three ways are the most common.
Tim Johnson, ABC's medical editor. Is the blood supply in the country safe?
It's not perfectly safe. The estimates would say that somewhere between 1 out of 150,000 to maybe 300,000 units could be infected with the AIDS virus. But since screening tests were put into practice in the spring of 1985, it has become much, much safer, and the risk of getting infected by a blood transfusion is far less than getting hit by a car crossing the street.
Okay, we'll be back in just a moment to talk about prevention.
Growing up in the age of AIDS, this ABC News special will continue in a moment.
Flakes? What can I say? I mean, they look kind of stupid just sitting there. Lights out, nobody's home. I mean, look, there's no fruit, there's no raisins, there's nothing in here. There's something about this. It's kind of simple. It's really crunchy. You know, I like them.
Kellogg's Corn Flakes.
Kellogg's Corn Flakes? Cool.
Taste them again for the first time.
Everyone has a dream, a vision deep inside.
When I decide to follow up on an investing idea, I need a broker who's ready when I am.
We make it easier to follow your own lead.
I can call Schwab at any hour, nights or weekends, get the information I need, even place an order to trade.
Always there to give you just the help you need.
Help yourself at Schwab today.
Promise Spread has no cholesterol and is lower in saturated fat than leading margarines.
You make me feel so young.
Promise. Get heart smart.
The first time I switched pain relievers, it was from aspirin to Tylenol. Then recently, I switched again from Tylenol acetaminophen to Advil. You see, I got these really pounding headaches, and I found Tylenol didn't always get rid of all the pain. So I tried Advil and found that for my really tough headaches, 2 Advil worked better than 2 extra-strength Tylenol tablets, better than Tylenol gel caps. For my tough headaches, Advil just works better.
And for a cold, try Advil Cold and Sinus, advanced formula for the cold season.
It is estimated that over one half of all high school students in the United States have had sexual intercourse.
Not just here, but all over the country that kids are talking about sex. We were listening the other day to some kids in Lyndhurst, Ohio, talk about the subject. Here's a bit of what we eavesdropped on. Okay, we haven't got it quite ready, so let's take a question. Go ahead, you're on the line.
Hello?
Hello.
Yeah, my question is, with AIDS spreading so quickly among teenagers, both heterosexual and homosexual, why isn't the federal government actively promoting condom distribution in the high schools?
Seems like a logical... Seems like a logical question for Dr. Antonia Novello, who is the Surgeon General of the United States. Glad you could join us, madam. Can you answer the question?
Well, I think the most important thing is to see first how do the adolescents contract the virus, and then we can make an assessment of when is the condom utilized. And one of the things is to realize for them who are their partners, what kind of sex they do they have sexually transmitted diseases, and most importantly, do they know what is that places them at risk? So when you look into that, and you look into the first one, do they know who their partner is? 20% of adolescents have at least 4 sexual partners in their lifetime. Then when you look into what kind of sex do they do, I never thought that I would be discussing this in national television, but 10 to 26% have rectal intercourse. And when you talk to them, it's because to avoid pregnancy and or to keep virginity. If we ask, we find. The other thing that is important is that every 30 seconds in this country, an adolescent contracts a venereal disease, the gonorrhea, a chlamydia. So when you look into that, they are placing themselves at risk, perhaps unknowingly. But the issue is, do we give condoms for condoms' sake? And when you just give them for condoms' sake, you're just giving a latex product that is not going to be utilizable. A study showed that when you look into the condoms instruction, you need at least 12 grades of education to understand it. And most importantly, if you do not use it correctly, store it properly, then the failure rate perhaps increases. Mm-hmm. So when the family knows it, the schools knows it, the community knows it, and is accepted, by all means, give it. But never in the absence of the instructions, mm-hmm. never in the absence of education, and ever in the absence of shared responsibility. It's not just the man, it's the women and the partner involved into this.
How many of you applauded when that question came in about distribution in schools? Let me go right up to the back here and ask the gentleman in the jacket with the blue sweater, what do you think of the Surgeon General's answer?
I think I don't quite understand it, because it seems like I understand it's maybe difficult for students to read questions, I mean, the instructions for condoms, but isn't a condom better than no condom at all? Doesn't it give people a chance to fight the disease and prevent getting it when maybe they wouldn't?
Let me ask that question of Dr. James Dobson, who we welcome from an organization of which he's the president and founded, called Focus on the Family. Can you make the argument for abstinence and no condom distribution?
Peter, I appreciate the chance to speak for abstinence, because we feel very, very strongly about this. I heard the applause, and it's obvious that that is what is accepted as the solution to this terrible epidemic that we're facing. But we strongly disagree with that, and for some very good reasons. The primary one is that condoms fail so frequently. For those who use condoms to prevent pregnancy, the failure rate is 15.7%. per year. Now, that is in a situation where you only can get pregnant 1 or 2 days a month. You can catch a disease 30 days a month, and the rate of failure is much, much higher. So we don't think we've been fair to young people to tell them this is safe, when in fact it is not safe.
Teenager. You a teenager?
No, 20.
You're 20. I need a teenager right here. You're a teenager. What about this argument that condoms fail and therefore you should abstain?
What do people that are having sex do, and what do you say to them? I mean, you can't just send them out there not knowing what they have to do to protect themselves.
Miles McPherson, former San Diego Charger, former coke addict, former alcoholic,
Peter,
youth evangelist. Now you preach abstinence.
When I played football, we had specific rules by which we played, and if you broke those rules, you were penalized. And there are certain rules about how to use sex. Sex is a beautiful thing. It's very enjoyable. When you go outside of those rules, you have consequences. The consequence we're talking about today is dying. And there is no sex, no orgasm that any man has ever experienced that I know of that is worth dying for. So if there's a question of whether you're going to die and you're going to trust your life in a thin latex bag, you have to ask yourself, how much sense is that? And you say, well, I'm going to trust my life with a thin condom. How much sense does that make?
Either of you young women like to discuss this with Mr. McPherson?
Oh, I think that if
teenagers are going to have sexual intercourse, they should be using a condom no matter what. You have to realize that there are teens who are going to have intercourse, and that's their choice. And it might be the wrong choice, but if they're going to do it, they have to protect themselves.
But like you said, it might be the wrong choice. And if the wrong choice is going to end in death, we need to rethink that choice. There are 100,000 gang members in L.A., and I don't see any police department or any FBI agency giving out bulletproof vests for those kids. They're taking the guns away and they're arresting them. Kids are on drugs. They're teaching them to say no. They're not giving them filter joints. People are going to die using condoms. People are going to die.
But if you're going to use a condom, it's important to know how to use it, I assume. Some of the people we have here in the studio represent a group in Princeton, New Jersey called High Tops, and they've taken it on themselves to go out and talk sex and AIDS with other kids their age. And we've asked two of them here this evening to show us a little bit about how they try to communicate with other kids. Do you mind, gentlemen?
Dad, I'm going out with Catherine tonight. I'll be home around 12 o'clock.
Dave, I'd like to have a quick word with you, if I may, before you go out.
I have to meet Catherine in about 5 minutes. I gotta...
Dave, I think this is really important. I think this is something we should discuss. Please stay.
Okay, go ahead.
The other day, I was going through the laundry, and I came across these condoms in your pants.
Dad, you had no right to go through my stuff.
I know, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to. They just fell out. I'm really concerned, David. Are you having sex?
Dad, that is none of your business. I can't believe you just asked me that.
Dave, of course it's my business. You're my son. I care about you and I love you. And there's a lot of stuff out there. I want you to be safe. I want you to be able to protect yourself. I mean, do you know how to use these?
Yes, I know how to use a condom. Okay.
Dave, I want you to show me.
Dad, I'm not going to show you how to put on a condom.
Dave, this is your life we're talking about. I mean, if you want me to get off of your back about this thing, you've got to prove to me that you know how to protect yourself.
All right. Look, what's so hard about it? You know, you open the package, you put on the condom. It's no big deal. You put on the condom.
David, I've done a lot of research about this, and I found out that condoms are not always reliable, and a lot of that has to do with the fact that people just don't know how to use them right. Well, look, hold this. First of all, you cannot open it with your teeth. That could tear the latex. Second of all, you have to check the expiration date to make sure that it's still fresh. Now, when you're ready to have sex, you gently tear the package open like this, all right? And then see the nipple here? You've got to squeeze that tip. And you gently roll it down over the penis, like this. You've got to make sure that there's no air in the tip, because it could pop during intercourse. That's very important. Then when you're done, you hold the rim like this, you withdraw, and you just unroll the condom. Throw it out. Never use a condom twice. Dave, if you're embarrassed about buying these, talk to me or your mother. I mean, we'll buy them for you. You know, we think that this is something that we should really talk about, Dave. We care about you, and we love you, and we want you to be safe.
All right, Dad, thanks. I appreciate it. I'm going to go now.
Okay. Remember, Dave, we'll talk more.
Well, you seem to communicate it very well. I must tell you, we didn't stack the audience either. We're joined today also by Martha Roper, who's a sex education teacher from St. Louis, Missouri. How do parents in your neck of the woods respond to that kind of a demonstration? Do they like you doing that?
Well, for one thing, I don't demonstrate a condom usage like that. I think that would be more of a teenager's nightmare than the parent's nightmare to have a banana, to pull out a banana. Does anybody agree with me that this would be the teenager's nightmare to have a parent pull out a banana? They would just die.
Why? You know, why?
I think every child dreads the moment that their parent says, "Sit down, William. I want to talk to you about sex." Of course, the joke is, then William says, "So, Mom, what do you want to know?" We have to really start talking about sex with our kids and condoms and how to use the condoms years and years before they're going to need to know it. They need to know the term non-oxyl 9. They need to know that there's a variety of kinds of condoms. And when you're talking about sex, You have milk and cookies. You know, you're elbow to elbow.
Do you carry those cookies with you all the time?
I have, just in case. I have
But tell me, how did they do, those two young men?
They did fine, except that I feel, well, you forgot about the non-oxal 9. That's okay. In parenting, we have many, many second chances, and that's good. And you know what? One initial response that I feel you missed was to say, hey, I found some condoms as I was doing your wash. I'm sorry, I really wasn't snooping, but I want to congratulate you on your responsibility. I am so proud of you.
All right, we'll be back in just a minute and continue this discussion of how to prevent AIDS.
The percentage of U.S. AIDS cases among adults and adolescents attributed to heterosexual contact has increased from 1% in 1985 to 6% in 1991.
Are we having orange juice with breakfast?
Daddy, of course we are.
Oh, these aren't the little glasses I'm used to.
Orange juice is good for you. Have a big glass.
Orange juice. It's got the vitamins, minerals, and taste that make you feel so good.
No bacon and eggs?
Nope. Bulgur wheat muffins.
100% pure Florida quality orange juice. It makes you feel so good.
I'll have seconds.
Another muffin?
No, orange juice.
Oh.
Did you know the cost of 2 9-page fax transmissions from these Philadelphia newspapers to Chicago may surprise you?
I got an exclusive interview.
With AT&T Pro Watts, your business can't get a more accurate way to send a fax.
She talks a lot.
And our prices are extremely competitive. Even though the other company would like you to believe, they always save you lots of money.
Wait a minute. That's news to me. Can I quote you on that?
AT&T Pro Watts, another AT&T advantage.
Drixoral is. Sudafed isn't. Drixoral is. Contac isn't. Drixoral is the only 12-hour cold medicine you can buy that was once a prescription and is still available in its original prescription strength. Drixoral.
Pain from just one sensitive tooth can start the domino effect. Pain can make you stop brushing, lead to plaque buildup, gingivitis, periodontal disease, even tooth loss. Sensodyne toothpaste helps stop the pain and the domino effect.
In Washington, important news has been announced for anyone suffering from eczema, psoriasis, or other skin itches and rashes. Government officials have approved for sale without prescription extra strength medicine doctors prescribe for these problems. It's a new Cortisone 10, the maximum strength you can buy to relieve irritating itching and rash. Why suffer when now you can get the strong relief you need? Get Cortisone 10 with medicine doctors prescribe for relief of itch and rash. Now available without prescription.
In a recent poll, nearly 70% of Americans said they worried about health care coverage and costs. Now, ABC News makes an unprecedented commitment. Emergency, health care in America. Reports on every ABC News broadcast all this week.
Still to come, Salt and Pepper. The message is in the music. Tonight's ABC News special, Growing Up in the Age of AIDS, will continue after this from our ABC stations.
I had no time for romance, but he wouldn't give up.
Just the sight of you drives me crazy.
So what do you do when you meet a woman more stubborn than you are?
In our marriage, there are always new surprises.
Let life surprise you. One life to live. Your favorite memories tomorrow.
This is an ABC News special. Growing up in the age of AIDS. Once again, Peter Jennings.
We are trying to answer questions about AIDS. We're trying to have people understand their fears and their prejudice about AIDS. We're glad you're with us. If you have a question from somewhere in the country, call us. Our number is 1-800-648-8094. We'll try to get to it. You've just seen two young men who've been out trying to educate other teenagers about the use of condoms if they're going to use condoms. It's not necessarily our position to advocate one form of behavior or the other. But I'm told that somewhere back here the boys' mothers are. How, are you comfortable with your son's behavior on this score?
Yes.
When they first did it for you, were you, you need a microphone. Who's our microphone holder back? Ah, thank you.
Yes, I'm very comfortable because I feel that I would like him to be protected all the time, and I would like him to be educated so he can not only protect himself and also his partner. And did you notice that I just partner, not partners?
Right.
And I hope you will stick to it.
Now, did you, who had the first sex discussion about sex in the family?
Well, when David was 6 years old and I
put your hand up here, David. Okay.
And I explained signs of puberty to him. He thought he was going to change into a werewolf. So I'm glad that he's getting it somewhere else, probably better that I could do it. Okay. And maybe now Matt's mother can say something.
Yeah, what do you think? Are you embarrassed when your children first began to discuss sex? In my generation, we didn't talk about sex like this at all. We whispered about it at the very best.
Well, I come from a different background. I come from Europe, and it was much more open than it is here.
Okay, so. And what about Matt's mother?
Regarding what?
Do you feel comfortable with your son? Are you as easy discussing sex with him as he appears discussing it with David?
I think he's far more comfortable. He's had a lot more experience. I have two children that I've had discussions with. He does this on a regular basis, and I applaud him for it. I think it's extremely important. And I admire him. I think he and David and all their colleagues are doing a very important thing.
I want to ask Dr. Karen Hine, who's sitting beside the boys, who's written this wonderful book called Trading Fears for Facts, whether or not you think most parents are as comfortable as this foursome is talking about sex.
Well, we've had a wonderful demonstration of the vigor and enthusiasm that age brings along with it. As the AIDS generation, these kids are growing up and don't remember a time before the epidemic. For parents, we didn't discuss this stuff over the dinner table. Our parents never broke the ice with us. So really, what we have to do in this case is to recognize as adults, it may be hard for us, but it's easier for the kids, and we can learn from them.
Okay, I want to come back a little later in the broadcast and talk a little more about how we can learn from them, and perhaps they can learn from us, or at least learn from you, if not from all of us. But we have a telephone call from Georgia. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I would like to know, how long does it take for the HIV virus to show up? For instance, if you and your partner are in a monogamous relationship and for the past year you've both tested negative, does that mean you do not have HIV?
Dr. Tim Johnson, our medical editor.
To answer specifically, if they have both been truly monogamous and have both tested continuously negative for a year, it is highly unlikely that either one of them is infected. Once the AIDS virus enters into the bloodstream, it takes a matter of weeks or months before the test will become positive for the antibodies produced by the test or by the virus. So you have that window between initial infection and the time the test becomes positive, and that's always a danger period because you may have no indication from the test that you have the AIDS virus. The test is still negative, but you're carrying the virus and you could transmit it.
Are kids in general, maybe you can help me, are kids in general worried about testing, do you know? Do you ever hear other kids talk about it?
No, I know I'm worried about the needles and all that because I'm scared of shots, but that, I mean, I'd get it if there were another form. I'm just worried about the needles and all that.
And what is your sense about this in terms of whether or not children are afraid of testing or not?
I think it's just at least I'm talking age 14. I don't think it has hit that way yet.
Okay. One of the senses we get in talking to teenagers, at least before the program, is that this question of testing is indeed quite worrisome, so we thought we might spend a little time with it, and we're very glad for the question from Georgia. I said there were some kids here who've tried to communicate with other kids their fears and their anxieties and their education. I'd like you to meet a young woman now whose name is Carrie, and she is going to play at this moment another young woman named Jessie. Carrie?
Eric is this guy I'm going with. He's so perfect. Curly brown hair, green eyes, tall, built, 22. When he comes to pick me up at school, every girl's head turns. I throw my bag in the back seat, hop in the front with him, and when everybody else has to take the train or the bus home, I get driven wherever I want. I mean, we do everything together. I lost it with Eric. He's the reason why I'm here in this doctor's office. I'm here to take some kind of AIDS test that I don't really know much about. See, Eric was a drug dealer, and I knew that, because the money had to come from somewhere, the earrings, the ring. But what I didn't know was that Eric was shooting up. He was taking his own drugs. So a friend of mine told me that she heard Eric had AIDS or HIV or something. But it didn't hit me until this counselor came to my school and she started talking about AIDS and HIV and unprotected sex. And I realized that when we did it, we didn't use anything. Because he told me that he would take care of everything, that to trust him. So I called him, and basically he said, don't worry about it, Jesse. I'm not worried about it, which basically means that he's not worried about me. I mean, I thought he loved me. He said that he loved me. How am I supposed to deal with this? I'm only 14. I mean, who can I talk to about this? I don't know how to reach the counselor that came to my school. I can't talk to my mother. She'd kick me out the house. If I told my friends, they would think I was a slut. I don't even understand this pamphlet that I got. It says if you test positive, you may or may not get AIDS. I mean, what does all this mean? It's so confusing. I gotta get out of here.
Dr. Hine is the director of the Adolescent AIDS Program at Montefiore Hospital in the Bronx in New York City, if I've got that right?
Yes.
How many kids do you see like Jesse?
Well, when we opened our doors in 87, we had no patients at all, and we were made fun of and called the Emperor's New Clothes Clinic. Now we have 65 teenagers with HIV and just a whole city full of young people who are at risk. So that the question of the test is a very serious one for people who have had unprotected intercourse. But I would say to young people that it is a very serious decision and that it's best to really think through with a counselor, what would you do if you're positive? What would you do if you were negative? Being negative is not a life insurance policy for the rest of your life.
First of all, I'm not sure that kids altogether, not to mention adults, know exactly what's involved in the test. Let's go, if we may, to the Whitman Walker Clinic in Washington, D.C., which is where you can go and have an AIDS test. And our medical editor, our medical correspondent, rather, George Strait, is standing by. George, when someone comes there to have an AIDS test, what happens?
Well, Peter, first of all, most of the people who come to a testing center like this are people who have some concern about their lifestyle that may place them at risk. So before there is any kind of testing at all, what happens is that there is an assessment of that lifestyle and that risk assessment. Usually, there are a series of very serious questions that are asked for about 30 minutes. The first question usually is, do you have unprotected sex? And if so, how often? And if you do have unprotected sex, then the counselor usually wants to know, how many sexual partners do you have in a year, in 6 months, in 3 months? And do you know these people? Do you know their lifestyles? So there are a number of very simple but very serious questions that are asked. Finally, after about 30 minutes and a lot of good counseling, what happens is that the person is then taken down into a laboratory, the blood is drawn, and the test is made. It's really a test to see if that person has been exposed to the AIDS virus.
How long does it take to get the results?
It usually takes 3 or 4 days for the results to come back, and I might say, Peter, those are usually very anxious days.
How much does it cost?
If you went to a doctor's office, it would be $30 or $40, but there are centers across the country, centers like here in Washington, D.C., where the test is free. Mm-hmm.
Now, there are at least a couple kids here who have questions for whomever. What's your question?
Here you are stressing the importance of getting an AIDS or HIV test, but isn't it true that in 34 states you can't get tested for AIDS without your parents' permission? And don't you feel these kids are walking time bombs and they need to get tested and people need to find out the results?
Dr. Hine, can you answer that question?
Only a few states have actually laws now about HIV consent for teenagers, and in those states, many of them actually do give teenagers consent. In other states, they treat it as another sexually transmitted disease, and in all states in the United States, a teenager can be diagnosed and treated for a sexually transmitted disease without parental consent or knowledge. The real point here is that it's a big decision, and it's best to try to have some adult to talk to about it. There are tests that all should be done not only confidentially, but obviously with the consent of that teenager. And I personally and many people are opposed to the mandatory testing that does occur in some of the large programs for young people, including the military and the Job Corps.
Another question from a young man here behind me. Yes, sir.
I just want to say one thing about condoms. And before, one of the experts had...
Forgive me interrupting. You've got a question about testing, too?
Coincides. Okay, before, one of the experts had said that condoms fail frequently, be that as it may. When you go into, a clinic and ask, one of the questions they ask you is, do you use condoms? Would this be one of the questions they would ask if condom failure was as frequent as people would have us believe?
Good question, Dr. Hine.
First of all, this business about knowing your partner, that's not really very useful because, in fact, 90% of the people with the virus don't even know it themselves. So really, the real point is that if you're having unprotected intercourse, it's best to know more about HIV and to consider the test. It's the counseling that really counts. If you decide to have the test, that's one thing. It should be a knowledgeable decision. And that you might have at your doctor or clinic office or through Planned Parenthood or a whole number of places. But it's really the education that's the big step. The test is easy to do. It's just a little bit of blood.
I'm told there's some reasons not to be tested. David Barr, you're a lawyer with the Gay Men's Health Crisis in New York City. And am I right that some people, there were some reasons not to be tested?
Well, there's a lot of danger that can come from having a test result. Your name in 26 states right now, your name gets reported to a State Department of Health, which is supposed to keep those names confidential, but that doesn't always happen. And people are subject to discrimination. They lose their jobs. They lose touch with their families. You know, she said, my mother will throw me out of the house. That's not an unusual occurrence. You can lose your housing. You can lose your health insurance. The other point is that the testing in and of itself is not the key. The key is that you got to be able to get your T cells tested, and you got to be able to get to a doctor and get treatment. The majority of adolescents that we're talking about here don't have access to a doctor, whether or not because they can't tell their families, or because they don't have any health insurance, and their families don't have any health insurance.
Stephen Young is here from the Insurance Industry Association of America. Have I got that close?
Health Insurance Association of America.
Health Insurance Association of America. If someone goes and takes an AIDS test and they turn up HIV positive, they automatically going to lose their insurance or never get it again?
No, absolutely not. Actually, the situation is this. For those who have their health insurance through a larger employer, they generally do not require any testing or health history at all, and they're safe. Medicaid does not require any testing or history, and they're safe. If you're working for a smaller employer where there is what is known as a health experience, which produces some larger claims, then there's the possibility of a problem on the renewal of that policy for the employer. And for that, the Health Insurance Association is proposing an absolutely radical reform in which we are asking the legislatures to pass a law which will guarantee that smaller employers be offered comprehensive health insurance with reasonable premiums, irrespective of the health experience under those policies.
Sound reasonable to you, Mr. Barr, from experience?
It sounds reasonable, but it's just not true. Frankly, what happens if I go from one large employer to another large employer and
okay,
I want to carry
I'm
my
glad
insurance
you asked
over?
That question. Well, it's not true now because the legislatures haven't passed our bill, but a key provision of our proposal is what's called portability. Once an employer, one employee, is covered by such a policy, he or she will permanently be covered even if the employer changes health insurance carriers or even if the employee changes jobs. And that includes protection for the employee's family as well. So when the HIA reforms are passed by the legislatures, the problem you cite will be dealt with.
Peter, the fact is that the HIAA sued the state of New York because they wanted HIV information. They wanted to be able to test every person who was applying for a health or life insurance policy that wasn't through their employer. If I didn't get health insurance through my job and I needed to get a private policy, they would give me a test, I would test positive because I am positive, and I would be denied insurance.
Well, we have to get the facts
all right,
straight.
All right, hold it. It's a
who
battle
no
we can go
access
on.
To health
Dr.
Hyatt,
will
all.
You intervene here and just
sure.
try to give
the,
us the last
we're
comment
talking
on this?
About teenagers.
That's exactly.
25 million teenagers in this country have no health insurance. 1 in 7. 1 in 3 of the poor teenagers in this country have none. Most teenagers are not covered by their family's insurance policy. This is a small issue for teenagers regarding HIV. In fact, the tests often can be free. It's really the link to services, the fact that teenagers don't have age-specific services in many cases. So that if a teenager is thinking about being tested, one of the first questions to ask is, what would happen if I'm positive? Who will take care of me? Will that person know about my age group? And then to ask questions like, what will happen to my records? Will an insurance company turn me down in the future or currently? So they're really a series of very specific questions that have to do with teenagers. But when we're talking about insurance, millions and millions of teenagers have none.
Okay, Dr. Hine, thanks very much. We'll come back and continue our discussion and try to answer some phone calls in just a moment.
Growing up in the age of AIDS, this ABC News special will continue in a moment.
Filled with delicious pepperoni pizza, chicken and cheddar, or ham and cheese in a crispy pocket.
When it's late at night and you want a tasty bite, what are you gonna pick?
Hot Pockets!
The hot meal in a pocket.
What are you gonna pick?
Hot Pockets!
Try Lean Pockets, too.
The technology didn't come from Germany. It didn't come from Japan. The technology that made this the most fuel-efficient V8-powered luxury car you can own came from Lincoln. Lincoln Town Car. What a luxury car should be.
Today's contact takes on...
Kimberly's miserable cold. I feel like there's clay or something just blocking everything. I'm congested.
Well, didn't you take a cold pill?
It didn't last long enough.
That's because ordinary cold pills can quit working after just 4 hours. Try Contact. You'll get continuous relief for up to 12 hours.
I feel great. It still hasn't worn off. I can breathe. I don't have a runny nose. I talked on the phone all day. Kimberly's miserable cold is gone.
Today's Contact, 12 hours stronger than Kimberly's miserable cold.
Ooh, it took a cold morning like this one for me to discover a really great hot cereal for my family. And who would have expected? It's Grape Nuts. I just pour Grape Nuts, add milk, and microwave for a minute. Mmm, it's got a warm, smooth, hearty taste. That's so delicious, we all love it. And Grape Nuts is fat-free. It's the perfect way to help keep us all going on a cold winter's morning. Hot, delicious Grape Nuts. Try it for yourself.
Hot or cold, breakfast with Post Grape Nuts cereal helps keep you going strong all morning long.
By the end of 1991, there were 12,420 reported AIDS cases in persons 24 years of age and under. Of those, there have been some 7,000 deaths.
So much ground to cover. Let's go to Texas. You're on the line.
Mr. Jennings?
Yes, sir?
In the prevention of AIDS, do you think that the media bombardment of selling products with the use of sex, from beer to autos, there's always a sexy person selling these products, even underwear. Do you think that the commercial leads to sexual wild behavior? And do you think the media should take some responsibility in helping this problem? Because as long as it's exposed to teenagers, they're going to always feel that it's right.
Well, one of the things I know... one of the things I've learned about... the media is we tend to listen to the public on most subjects when the public speaks loudly enough to us. What do you think about that? Do you think that the media is doing a bad job or a good job?
Me?
Hmm.
I think the media is doing a very bad job because
It's just it, the way they portray people, especially videos, for example, they have a lot of sexual, you see a lot of sexually active people. And so a lot of people think that's okay, that they can, you know, they see these people having sex or whatever, and they just, they think it's okay.
What do you think back there? Do you think the media's doing a good job or a bad job on selling products using sexual, what, suggestive selling?
Well, I think that the media doesn't have any type of correlation between using sex as a way to sell things and having safe sex portrayed in that type of advertising. So, yeah, I mean, yeah, it gives mixed messages. It's giving you the message that, that it's okay.
What about the young man next to you?
I think the media is not doing a good job at all. One of the things in a lot of the movies that I see, the movie players, they have sex, and there's no showing of condoms or any kind of safe sex. So maybe kids are getting the impression that they don't have to use a condom, and that's not what we need.
And the woman next to you?
Well, it's kind of ironic that there can be no condom advertisements, yet there's all this sex on television and movies.
And the gentleman next to you?
Well, I feel the media is doing a terrible job portraying sex, but the simple fact is you see everybody doing it, and then I feel like, my personal opinion is, like, I see everybody doing it, that makes me want to do it, because it feel like, I feel like, and I think teenagers feel that it's like the thing that's happening and everybody wants to do it. And so I feel like they're doing a terrible job.
Yes, sir. Gentleman over here. Go ahead.
Yeah, one of the things I think that, we need to look at here, and it's something that I've heard throughout the whole program so far, is a very clinical look at AIDS. We're not looking at relationships.
Can we stay on the media for a second? You think the media is doing a good job,
well,
or a bad job?
That's ties in with it. On the media, you see a beer commercial, and it's all, you know, guys calling up to girls calling up to a guy in their room, and right away there's contact, but there's no relationship, and the media pushes stuff that is false. By the way, there's also no ads on television for Just Say No to premarital sex. Wait, because everybody's body is beautiful and precious. And if we begin to have respect for ourselves, maybe we'll say, wait a second, there is a right way and there is a wrong way. And let me try to find the right way, and then that will help in this whole process of spreading AIDS.
This is a view, by the way, not just exclusive to New York studio. I told you earlier, we've been eavesdropping earlier in the week on some kids out in Ohio. Here's what they had to say on this subject.
Because it's just everywhere you turn, every channel, every commercial, billboards, sex is related to everything.
Yeah, it gets you pumped up. If you turn to MTV or anything, you see this girl in a tight dress, you know, and she's looking good. I mean, she's looking good.
And the way we see it in TV and movies might want us to do it, because everyone that does it in the movies looks like they're enjoying it, so.
7 o'clock in the morning to find it, and 1 o'clock in the afternoon to find it, and you can find all different kind of times on TV. So.
Where's the microphone for this crowd here? I want to give it to these guys down here. What did you think of that? Where do you come down on this subject?
I didn't like it at all, because, I mean, the guy is always the one coming on to the woman, and she's always passive, and, you know, she looks like she won't have any say except what he wants her to do. You know, and she's always the one that, you know, that says, you know, yes, but there's never a no, or can we sit down and talk about it? You know, what do you have to say about this?
I'm not sure this is the most representative group of the world. Can I have a show of hands from teenagers, at least? I don't know the widest shot we can get here. How many of you think that television advertising emphasizes sex to too great a degree to sell products? Yes? All those agree? Well, certainly more than not. Now, help me here. What about all the rock groups and the rap groups who sing about sex all the time? Do you like to listen to those lyrics? You?
I think that all of it mostly is about, you know, let's have sex. We don't really just let's go and have it. It's not like I really like you a lot or anything. It's, you know, it's just like let's do it. Forget about
it. So rock groups and rap groups get to it pretty quickly as well, just like the advertisers?
Yeah.
What do you think of that?
About sex is that swept away is the way to go, and I think especially dealing with preventing diseases, especially AIDS and pregnancy, swept away is not the way.
to go. You have to be prepared beforehand. And I think that's a major problem with getting teens to use contraception and prevention is because when you actually take out the condom and begin to put it on, then you realize that you're not getting swept away, and then it's an actual commitment.
Your view?
Well, you never see anybody on a soap opera get pregnant, and nobody on a soap opera gets AIDS, and I'm here to tell you it happens. You know, make it bad for once. Make it happen the way it really happens in the world, and then you can show it, but at least you're not glamorizing it and making it seem like nothing bad is ever going to happen to you if you do this.
When we were preparing for this program, we came upon a number of rock groups and rap groups. We became upon a song called Let's Talk About Sex, which I think more of you know than not by the rap group Salt-N-Pepa. And the lyrics of that song probably make a middle-aged parent like me hair curl a lot of the time. But we were very, very pleased when they decided that for this broadcast they would rewrite the lyrics to that song from Let's Talk About Sex to Let's Talk About AIDS. And this is as good a chance as any, I think, to listen to it.
Come on,
let's talk about sex, baby. Let's talk about you and me. Let's talk about all the good things and the bad things that may be. Let's talk about sex.
About AIDS.
Go on.
To the unconcerned
and uninformed.
You think you can't get it?
Well, you're wrong.
Don't dismiss this or blacklist the topic.
And that ain't gonna stop it.
Now, if you go about it right, you just might
save your life.
Don't be uptight.
Come join the fight.
We're gonna tell you how you can get it
and how you won't.
All of the do's
and all of the don'ts.
I got some news for you, so listen, please. It's not a black, white, or gay disease. Are you ready, Pep?
Yeah, I'm set.
All right, then, come on, bet.
Let's talk about sex.
So if you do come up HIV positive or have AIDS,
yeah,
we just want you to know
what?
That there are treatments.
That's right.
And the earlier
the sooner
detected, the better off you'll be.
Tell them, please.
Ayo, Pep, you get checked?
Yep. Every year, G.
Now.
You don't get AIDS for kisses, touches, mosquito bites,
or hugging.
Toilet seats, telephone.
Stop bugging.
You get it for sex
or a dirty drug needle,
anal or oral. Now, people,
women can give it to men and
men mostly to women.
The facts are simple, right, and exact.
And once you get it, there's no turning back for you.
There ain't a cure,
so you gotta be sure.
Protect yourself.
I don't have sex anymore.
Mothers might give it to their babies through the womb
or through birth.
Don't be an ass and assume. AIDS ain't got no smell or taste.
It don't care about your race.
You see a nice kind face?
You think you're safe?
I'm sorry, that's just not the case.
There's no debate,
conversate
with your mate.
And don't wait until it's too late.
Don't.
Take
it easy.
Let's talk about sex, baby. Yeah. Let's talk about you and me. Yeah. Let's talk about all the good things and the bad things that may be. Let's talk about sex. Let's talk about sex.
Do it.
Let's talk about sex.
Ladies, all the ladies, loud now, help me out. Come on, all the ladies,
let's practice safe sex.
All right, ladies, all the ladies, loud now, help me out. Come on, all the ladies,
let's practice safe sex.
All right. Yo, Saul,
what?
You know what else would stop the spread of AIDS? If everybody stopped cheating and messing around and just stayed with one person.
And wear condoms.
Let's talk about sex, baby.
Is that a good message for you? Easy for you to understand?
I think that it's a good message because I think that if people are going to sleep together, I think that condoms make it somewhat safer. But my own personal opinion, I think abstinence is the only way to go.
Do you have a hard time ever talking to your parents about sex?
No.
No?
No.
Do you have a hard time talking to your parents about sex at all?
Yeah. I don't talk with them much about that. No.
Okay. Well, when we come back, we're going to try to talk a little more about sex and a little bit more about AIDS. Because as someone said, how to talk to kids so they'll listen and how to listen so kids will talk. We'll be right back.
Promise Spread has no cholesterol and is lower in saturated fat than leading margarines.
You make me feel so young.
Promise. Get heart smart.
It's a beautiful morning.
Was it the color television?
Gonna ride roller coasters, French fries.
Or that kids 12 and under stay free.
Six, seven, eight, milkshakes too.
Or the great location. One thing's for sure.
It's a beautiful morning.
Days in, isn't it time you wake up to us?
I think I'll go outside and just smile.
Only two American-made luxury automobiles provide both driver and passenger side airbags. One of them is a Lincoln. And the other one is a Lincoln. With Lincoln, it's easy to be on the safe side. Lincoln, what a luxury car should be.
We're flattered that after 60 years, people still get impatient for the natural whole grain goodness, Roman meal bread. Kind of proves we've had it right all along. Roman meal, it's that good.
After my heart attack, my doctor prescribed a regimen of exercise, eating right, and Therapy Bear enteric aspirin. Enteric means it's safety coated so it doesn't dissolve till it's past your stomach.
Therapy Bear enteric aspirin.
ABC News AIDS Special, The Truth and Consequences of Unprotected Sex, One Person's Story.
I was exposed to the HIV virus when I was 17, my senior year in high school, by my second sexual partner.
Tonight's ABC News special, Growing Up in the Age of AIDS, will continue after this from our ABC stations.
Next, can't wait to crack up? Well, you'll be blown away by an all-new action-packed edition of America's Funniest Home Videos.
Oh, boy.
Then...
you can get killed chasing after your fortune and glory.
Harrison Ford, Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom, tonight at a special time.
Growing Up in the Age of AIDS. This ABC News special continues. From Studio One in New York, Peter Jennings.
It's not an admission I'm particularly comfortable with, but when we went into this program, I think we had no idea how much we weren't going to be able to talk about. I want to take the next little block now and just talk about talking and how good communication is between adults and young people about AIDS. And so we're just going to go around and listen to some people we haven't had a chance to talk to, beginning, if I may, with Yolanda Serrano, who goes out very often trying to talk to people about AIDS and trying to communicate to people about AIDS and about prevention of AIDS. Ms. Serrano, what's your impression in terms of how well adults and teenagers are talking to each other?
Well, the young adolescents that we work with in the streets basically are homeless, are addicted, are on their own, have no one really to talk to. We basically feel they've lost communications, they've been thrown out. So they have a very difficult time out there in the streets. They're prostituting in order to get the drugs that they need. They're prostituting with 15, 20 individuals per day. The situation is really grave. We also have a whole generation of mother, daughter, grandmother out on the streets because of crack use.
What do you do? How do you break through when you're talking to girls on the street like that?
To tell you the truth, we don't have a hard time. They come and they want help, and we basically hold their hand and show an interest in them. And from that step, they are willing to go into treatment. They're willing to accept our services. Mm. The people out there are begging for services.
Dr. Ruby Hearn is the vice president of the Robert Woods Johnson Foundation. You're the largest health charity in the country. You give an enormous amount of money privately to help people educate on this subject. How badly or how well are people talking to each other on the subject, and what could we do better?
Well, I think that people are beginning to talk more about it, and it's very important that that happen. But I think, as someone was saying the other day, they can't always talk about it with their parents. And so we have been supporting the development of school health services so that school-based health centers can be available where the kids are, so they can have somebody that they can go and talk to about this problem and have a long-term relationship, not just an episodic relationship, but a primary care contact who can talk with them about the disease and their concerns. And we've been talking about kids getting tested and a lot of things here, but we haven't mentioned that access to health care for young people is a major problem, particularly in the areas that are hardest hit by this epidemic. And that's a problem that we need to address, not only in terms of AIDS, but also other problems that we're not doing so well with.
Do kids know where to go and ask questions about health care?
Well, they do if they have these centers in their schools, and they have accepted them very enthusiastically. But there are many communities where they don't know where to go.
Let me go. I have a feeling I'm standing in front of you, and I apologize. Do you know where to go to talk about AIDS? Do you know where to go to get advice?
Yes, I do.
Yeah. What about the young woman next to you? Do you know where to go?
Yeah, I do. There's a couple of centers that I know about that teenagers can go to. They could go for counseling. I go there too, and you could get tested. And what I like about it is that it's all confidential. If you don't want to talk to your parents about it, if you're too scared to, you know, it's all closed in.
Dr. Adele Faber, How to Talk So Kids Will Listen and Listen So Kids Will Talk, the title of your book. How bad is it between kids and adults from an adult's point of view?
Oh, from the parents' point of view, it's terrifying. It was always hard to talk about sex, but now all we want to do is say, don't stop, I'll kill you if I catch you. And what we really need to do is listen to the kids and hear them and hear their questions and hear their concerns and not jump in with threats and warnings and judgments and punishments, because then they're going to close off.
I want you to help us with this young man down here. I don't know. What's your name?
Brian.
Brian, come with me for a second. I want to get you close to a microphone, if I may. Brian, I hope I don't embarrass you, but you said you had a hard time talking to your mother about sex. Would you mind being his mother for just a moment? What did you have a hard time talking to your mom about?
Well, I don't believe, I believe in abstinence, and I don't believe that I need to talk to her because I know about AIDS, and we have talked, but it's just not something that we need to talk about.
Would you agree with that in most cases, that kids don't need to talk to their parents about it?
Oh, I think they desperately want to. They want to have access. I mean, the parent is the most important person in their life.
Is there anything you don't know?
And they...
Sure.
I mean, they want to know what the parent is thinking.
Find out what he doesn't know.
Find out what he doesn't know? I might not have to find out what he doesn't know. I don't want to poke at him with questions. I find that if I'm really listening and really responding in an honest way, that he'll come to me. In other words, if my response to his position, which is what, young man, you're saying, I believe in abstinence. So my answer would be, so you've looked at the problem and you've decided that the only way to go is abstinence.
Right. But I believe if I do have a problem, I can come to my parents.
All right,
and
now,
talk to them.
Yeah. it's my acceptance of his position which enables him to come to me with a problem.
Okay, I must confess I chose on you. I feel a little badly because you said you couldn't talk to your mother. Do you have a problem talking to your folks at all?
No problem talking to my folks. I feel
before you can make responsible decisions, you have to have access to information. And I feel it's really important that the government, that the schools, that the parents all tell teens what we need to know to make those decisions. And if that doesn't happen, then we have a real problem.
Dr. Faber, what is the, from a parent's point of view, the most difficult point at which children and adults miscommunicate? There doesn't seem to be much miscommunication here this evening, but I wonder if this is a representative family.
It's hard. It's hard for a parent to sit still and not jump in and direct and control that child. You care so much. You want him safe. And when the youngster says, gee, what'll I do? Danny's really pressing me to have sex with him. You really want to say, are you crazy in this age of AIDS and sexually transmitted diseases?
Well, what do you say instead of that?
And instead, you really start where the child is. Oh, so you're really being pressured to have sex? And she says, yeah. And then I say, from your response, I see that you're not completely comfortable about it. In other words, I'm encouraging talk. Well, yeah, because, and then as she talks and as I listen, then I have a chance for my input.
Is there any girl here who'd like to speak to this point of being pressured into having sex? Carrie?
Yeah, I think it's something that happens to a lot of girls. I think that what's important and what programs like High Tops and Star, which is the theater company that I perform with, I think what we try and do is empower teenagers so that they feel comfortable about making decisions for yourself. I mean, you can make the decision for abstinence, you can make the decision to have sex. What's important is that you're educated enough to make the decision that's right for you and that you take the responsibilities that go with that.
Miles McPherson, you wanted to say something.
I agree with her. Teenagers want the right information, and we say safe sex and protected sex, and we see videos on it. Safe means to be free from harm. And if a condom can guarantee you 100% freedom, which it can't, then it is safe. It doesn't make it morally right. It may be safe. Condoms do not protect you 100%. Mm-hmm. So I don't think we should be using safe or protected with a condom.
Martha Roper, last comment at this moment from you. These, maybe my imagination, but these sound like very sophisticated kids. Are they normal the way they talk about sex and education?
I find this to be true, with the exception that in my classroom I always give a lot of time to the kids who want to talk about abstinence. Abstinence is the way to go as long as you can wait. And with an abstinence-only program, you don't get a full understanding. Parents aren't satisfied with an abstinence-only program because they want their kids to pretty much know everything, including contraceptive and protective information. We'd like to get the abstinence kids to stay abstinent longer. Some programs really work, but I let them talk about that in my classes.
There's a gentleman way up at the top. Last comment from you, thanks. Do you think that, are we getting it wrong that kids and adults do talk quite easily, quite well about AIDS and sex?
No, my parents just taught about abstinence, and my sister got pregnant at 15. I lost my virginity at 16. Most teachers just talk about abstinence, because if you just say no, then they can just deny the fact that, you know, teens are sexually active. And there are so many kids in my high school who got pregnant before the senior year, and like high schools don't even talk about birth control till the senior year. And parents, it's a lot easier for parents to just say no, and just saying no doesn't work.
Okay, thank you very much. We'll be back in just a moment.
One-third of females and one-fifth of males remain virgins as they enter their 20s.
Today, Dectret Shoe Corporation announced a major retail expansion in 25 U.S. cities.
When I see a company that looks like a good investment, I check it out myself.
We make it easier to follow your own lead.
At Charles Schwab, I can get quotes, financial news, and when I make a trade, commission savings.
Always there to give you just the help you need.
Help yourself at Schwab today.
Did you know the cost of two business calls from these San Diego pet stores to Dallas may surprise you?
Of course they're easy to feed.
With AT&T Long Distance, your small business can get the quality you trust at extremely competitive prices.
They really do make perfect pets.
Even though the other company would like you to believe, they always save you lots of money.
That's my big savings?
That's it.
Not exactly the catch of the day.
Competitive price, another AT&T advantage.
At universities like this, clinical studies prove there's a way to lose weight simply and effectively without caffeine or caffeine nervousness. It's Dexatrim. Dexatrim helps you control your appetite so you can lose weight without feeling hungry. And no other weight loss product has more published medical studies to show that it works. In fact, studies prove that 4 out of 5 people lost weight with Dexatrim. Now that's powerful proof.
Dexatrim, medically proven to help you lose weight.
I'd like to talk to you about an invisible problem, the invisible bacteria that cause denture odor. Fortunately, antibacterial Efident kills those odor-causing bacteria for clean, fresh dentures.
Antibacterial Efident.
Drixoral is. Sudafed isn't. Drixoral is. Contac isn't. Drixoral is the only 12-hour cold medicine you can buy that was once a prescription and is still available in its original prescription strength. Drixoral.
Hard-working people paying good money for bad health insurance. They thought they were protected until illness struck. Then they were shocked to discover they weren't covered at all.
Since I had the heart attack, don't nobody want me.
Primetime Investigates Thursday.
I want to ask very briefly Dr. Jonathan Mann, who was with the World Health Organization and who is now the chairman of the International AIDS Conference that's going to be held in Amsterdam this year, to give us a quick review, Dr. Mann, of just how big a crisis this is in the world and how many young people are affected.
Well, overall, there are probably between 11 and 12 million people infected in the world today with this virus. Of those, probably 1 to 2 million are teenagers. And I've been sitting listening to this discussion thinking how similar the problems are that face teenagers around the world as they try to figure out how to live in a world with AIDS, how to access services, how to get information. But one thing that's striking everywhere is that people, young people, really do want to talk about sex. They just need the opportunity and they need the information.
Okay. Dr. Mann, tell me, do you find in your own experience, because you've been doing it a long time, that kids are listening?
I think they are. I think part of the problem is that sometimes we as ex-youth don't quite know how to talk to them or how to put ourselves precisely in their position. I think we have to give them those opportunities to speak to each other, to learn the facts. We have to make sure the services are available. And then we have to make sure that every possible avenue is taken. For example, just talking about abstinence, just talking about condoms, doesn't seem to work as well as making all the options available and then letting people choose, because they will choose in any event. And that's true everywhere around the world.
Well, as an ex-youth, you've stayed up. As an ex-youth, you stayed up rather late in Amsterdam. We are preparing for the International AIDS Conference, and we thank you very much. I think you make an excellent point. ABC's Beth Nissen the other day discovered a young woman who speaks most eloquently of what it's like to live with AIDS. Her name is Amy Dolph. Let us introduce you.
It happened right after the party where this photo was taken.
I was exposed to HIV virus when I was 17, my senior year in high school, by my second sexual partner. I had sex with somebody that I loved very much. And in doing so, I got infected.
Amy Dolph is now 22. She is living with HIV. Her immune system is still strong. She is on no medication. She has not been ill.
I don't feel like I'm dying. I feel like I'm living. I feel very much alive. Like when you have the virus, you don't feel it in you. You can't feel the effects. It's just there.
But finding out that the virus was there inside her put her whole life on fast forward.
The overriding feeling was a sense of hurry. I thought I had 50 years. How can we get 50 into 5?
She changed her college plans, enrolled in a 2-year school instead of a 4-year program.
First 2 years of college is hurry, 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 get this done, so I can get out in the real world and feel a little bit of the real world before I get sick or whatever.
She changed her career plans. There would be no time to work her way up to be CEO of a major corporation the way she'd dreamed.
The goal I've set for myself is a pretty big one, is to reach as many teenagers, to reach as many young people, and let them know they're at risk for this virus.
Amy now works at the AIDS Foundation in Houston. She tests teens on what they know about HIV and AIDS. She teaches them what no one at school taught her, what her parents did not know to tell her.
I didn't get the information. I've got the virus. Give the information. It makes sense.
She often teaches teachers.
You know, I always like to ask the question, is any boy or girl worth dying over? Because by looking at my boyfriend, I could not tell that he was at risk for this. I could not tell he was bisexual that even put him at risk.
AIDS may shorten her life, but AIDS does not define it.
I'm not Amy, the HIV positive person. I am Amy, the 22-year-old that is here to dance and have a good time. And I'm not just sitting on my bottom at home in self-pity and waiting to die.
Amy's social life is not over. Her sex life is not over.
I have had sex since finding out I was HIV positive. Partners have known. It's been with protection, condoms, spermicide.
Do your own friends practice safer sex because of your being HIV positive?
No.
God rewards people of faith.
So much is now left to prayer. How long before the first infection that won't go away? Which Christmas will be the last one? What can be done in each day, each encounter with a friend? Amy hopes for medical breakthroughs, but has already written her will. Her class ring goes to her best friend. Her cross goes to her sister. Her teddy bears go to her niece.
My fears are for the future generation. My fears are that the government and the parents and the society, everybody's going to wake up too late. They're going to wake up a little bit too late.
And Henry Nichols is living with AIDS. He's an Eagle Scout. He became public or went public as part of a leadership program in the Scouts, which was very courageous. Help us understand what it's like to live with AIDS.
First of all, let me say, I was infected around 10 years ago in 1983, around 10 years ago, I was 10 years old. And since that time, I have told no one that I have AIDS until last year. I didn't tell my best friend, my teachers, my relatives, not even my girlfriends, because I was afraid. Now, people with AIDS are afraid. People are afraid of AIDS patients. AIDS patients are afraid too. I was afraid that my friends and my family might reject me. They might move away from me. People with AIDS are afraid of this. I am another person living with AIDS. 3 weeks ago, I was in the hospital, and they didn't expect me to live through the night. They don't even know why I recovered. Like the woman on the video, this has changed my career plans. I said I'm an AIDS educator. Once when I was speaking, a seventh grader asked me what I wanted to do before I died. He figured this would be sometime next week, probably. And I thought about this, and I said, ever since I've been a very small child, I've always wanted to be president. Now, I know this sounds a little far off, and I know you have to be 35 to run for the presidency, so we figured it out in the year 2008. I'll be 34 for the primaries, but I'll turn 35 just in time for the election. So I'm going to run for the presidency. Even though you laugh, I like to remind you...
I'm not laughing at you, I must tell you. I'm smiling with you.
I'd like to remind you this is not a joke. This is a symbol that people with AIDS, you don't have to die. I'm living with AIDS. I'm not dying of AIDS.
Thank you very much. We'll be back in just a minute.
Growing up in the age of AIDS. Brought to you by Lincoln, what a luxury car should be.
Of town car. The performance of Mark 7. Lincoln. Now, more than ever, what a luxury car should be.
Flu epidemic declared. Entire U.S. affected. What will you do? Doctors recommend Theraflu. Hot liquid medicine that works fast. Theraflu. Strong therapy for flu symptoms.
Poly Shades by Minwax. It's a stroke of genius. Poly Shades is rich stain and polyurethane protection in one. Poly Shades gives wood a beautiful protective finish in half the time. Poly Shades by Minwax.
I mean, I've had some pretty good cereals in my time, but trouble with this cereal, it got no soul. I mean, it needs something to make it sing. All you got are flakes in a bowl. I should have put this in before I opened my mouth. Simple, crispy, it's good, all right?
Kellogg's Corn Flakes.
Kellogg's Corn Flakes. It's singing to me, baby.
Taste them again for the first time.
Boy, 90 minutes isn't very long. I hope we've helped a bit. If we have one wish, it's that our dialogue here may have loosened up conversation in your home. For as is awfully clear here, we must all go on talking about AIDS. There were many more phone calls than we could field, as some of you still on the telephone know. And thus, we want to leave you with a couple of other numbers which you may find useful. The National AIDS Hotline in Washington, which is 1-800-342-AIDS. In Spanish, Español, 800-344-SIDA, which is, of course, AIDS in Spanish, 800-344. And for the hearing impaired, 800-AIDS-TTY. There's also a hotline which is operated by teenagers, for teenagers primarily, and that number is 1-800-234-TEEN, teen, 1-800-234-TEEN. Thank you for joining us. Thank you, all of you here. You helped me a lot. I hope we helped each other a bit as well. Good night.
This has been an ABC News special, Growing Up in the Age of AIDS. Cassette version of Growing Up in the Age of AIDS. Use your Visa or MasterCard and call 1-800-ABC-7500. The cost is $19.98 plus $3.95 shipping and handling. If you wish to receive a transcript, please send $6 to Growing Up in the Age of AIDS. Journal Graphics, 1535 Grant Street, Denver, Colorado, 80203.
This has been a presentation of ABC News. More Americans get their news from ABC News than from any other source.
In a recent poll, nearly 70% of Americans said they worried about health care coverage and costs. Now ABC News makes an unprecedented commitment. Emergency, health care in America. Reports on every ABC News broadcast all this week.
Monday. Daddy love Adam.
A single man adopts a child.
I have a son.
It's all right.
Fetal alcohol syndrome.
Jimmy Smith stars in a story of love and triumph. The Broken Cord, Monday at 9, 8 Central.